Pulse Width Labs is a sort of division of MagFest, full of people who love excessively technical solutions to problems that are facing MagFest. And one of those problems is asset tracking. And really, we just want to know, is it something in this room or that room, or is it the hotel, or is it at the warehouse? And just kind of a very high-level picture. So no real-time localization or any of that. And we all had different ideas as to what we wanted to do to solve this problem. Some wanted to do LoRa, or some wanted to do RFIDs, and I chose the probably incorrect route of nothing else but an ESP8266. One of the biggest problems that we're going to run into is battery life, and thankfully, YouTuber Andreas Spies has already kind of looked into this. He's really done a lot as far as being able to show and test a bunch of ESPs to show they could last about a year on two AAs. For us, that's not enough, but thankfully, we don't have to do everything the same way he did. So, normally when you're using an ESP8266, the way it works is you'd use Wi-Fi to go connect to a home router. The home router would let you log on with a fairly complicated handshake back and forth. You'd get an IP, and then using that IP address through the router, you can talk to the internet and even send data to the cloud. And that's all fine and dandy, and that's exactly what Andreas did, but this is not going to work for us because, well, number one, many times there's no internet at all. So how are we going to work with these things without that? The other bigger problem is that when operating in this sort of way, well, I guess you should know about something called deep sleep. Deep sleep is something on the ESP8266, which allows it to go kind of dormant. And during deep sleep, it uses only about, well, 20 microamps of power, which is a very small amount of power. Then, when it wakes up, it can be set to wake up at a specific time, it uses a lot of power while it's doing this exchange and transmitting data to the internet. It actually uses about 70 milliamps, and that's a lot of power. Now, once it's done, it can go back to sleep and everything's fine, back down to the nice 20 microamp level. But the problem comes in, how long does this take? It means that any time you want your ESP to wake up and do something, it has to do all of that. And tests have really shown it's somewhere between, well, it's about 6 to 10 seconds. And that's just a long time. So we're going to have to make that faster. Now, because this is the only way that's supported in the ESP NanoS SDK, and by extension Arduino and pretty much all of the libraries anyone else uses, we're going to have to find a different way. In comes Victor, or PVVX, and he's somebody who's taken great lengths, like Herculean efforts, to reverse engineer the ESP's SDK and understand how it works and take it apart and be able to, well, allow people to do stuff with it that it was never intended. But his work seems largely unknown until more recently, at least to me. His SDK no Wi-Fi predated my ESP SDK without Wi-Fi by over a year, and he also did a better job than me to begin with. But what I'd really like to focus on is this amazing effort he's made in the Min ESP SDK Live. What he's done here is he's removed a lot of the components that are in the ESP's SDK and rewritten them and tightened them down and made them smaller and faster and better than even the official SDK, it seems. And, well, it's really cool what he's doing with this. And it allows us to go rip out all of this extra stuff, all of these extra layers, to get the chip to wake up, send messages, be able to receive a little bit, and go back to sleep ridiculously fast. The entire operation can happen in about 100 milliseconds, as you can see on this graph. So making the chip boot up, load the program, send a message to the network, and wait for a response in case it needs to stay alive or do a buzzer. This entire operation takes about 100 milliseconds, about 20 or more times faster than the normal way that you'd use an ESP8266 in this. And you can see here, it's actually a graph of power over time. So when the chip is booting up, it's only using about 30 milliamps down here. Then once it's loading the program a little bit more, maybe about 40 milliamps. Then once the program is booted and it sends that packet, only is it using that 70 milliamps of power, the thing that it used to be drawing a huge amount of power before, it's only doing that for about 20 milliseconds right here. So this is a significantly lower amount of power. In order to actually use this to send data to the internet, we do have to do something a little bit unusual. For this, I'm using regular off-the-shelf hardware, like this TP-Link router right here. The only difference is, instead of it running the normal TP-Link software, it's running OpenWRT, the most wonderful router software in the world. It's like DDWRT, but much more customizable and easy to develop for. So one of the first things I needed to know was, is it possible for the router here to both be connected as an infrastructure and at the same time able to talk these raw packets sending and receiving to the ESP8266? And the answer was yes. Actually, it was very easy. For my program, all I really had to do was just make something that connected to the wireless connection, set up a new dev as a PHY interface and our monitor mode, and I just print out a PCAP header. This is just a header for Wireshark. And anytime the data comes in, I just literally print the data out to standard out and see what happens. And what happened on the other side, after I ran the program and piped it into Wireshark-i-k, was, well, I saw all the data coming down the pipe. All of the random wireless packets that are flowing through the air, I can now look at, including the packets coming from the ESP8266. Now, I've marked them with the word VOLTTE, so they're easy for me to identify. And inside these packets, they contain things like the frame number and the voltage that's on the 3.3 volt rail. So, using this, I'm going to be able to do something kind of similar to what Andreas was doing. Still using a regular old router, just with a little bit of custom software. Unfortunately for me, data.sparkfun.com looks like it's not going to be a thing anymore, so I won't be able to use the same tricks Andreas did, so I'm going to have to look elsewhere. Instead, what I decided to use was the form thing on Google Docs. This allows you to go make a form for people on the internet to go fill out information and submit it. It also lets things that aren't people go fill out information and submit them too. So I went and created this whole thing and copied the curl line from it, which is just a command that you can execute to go send data, and ran that as a script on the TP-Link whenever it saw one of the VoltTE messages. As you can see, on the back of King Donut here, I have two coin cells, and these two coin cells are in parallel with 400 microfarad capacitor. And, well, thank you, King Donut, for being part of this project. And this is hooked up to the same old ESP, and this time it's been programmed to go much more slowly. In fact, now it's only updating it, I don't know, once every 10 seconds, I think it is. And there's something kind of neat that you can see. If you go watch the results, see how it's 93 results? As soon as the ESP blinks, you can actually see that number go up very quickly. So let's wait one more and we'll watch it blink. It's updating the fields in real time. So as soon as the LED blinks, boop, now 95 reports are in. And on top of that, we can then go look at the public results in a, and if you watch this, as soon as it blinks, and blink, another field automatically gets inserted into the table. How cool is that? There's a few other notes that I'd like to point out. One is, I did seem to have problems after a very, very long time. If I didn't do any calibrations at all, sometimes it seemed like the ESP's messages weren't getting to the TP-Link, and I'm not sure why. So one of the things I'm trying to do is every 64 blinks, I'm also doing a full calibration. So that does use more power, but I'm curious if that helps. All of the code is going to be on GitHub. One of the repositories is where I modified PVVX's Mi SDK and added the stuff to make it so it could be super duper stripped down and really fast. And then the other one is the TP-Link raw Wi-Fi project. And this is just where I have the stuff that has like the data logger, the remote capture, stuff like that. Turns out this attempt at ESP8266 with ESP Now didn't really work out. But yeah, I hope you guys like this, and I hope this works out, and I hope to be able to report back soon with what my findings are. Oh man, this is cool. Whenever the thing blinks, it automatically adds the new line and it updates the graph in Google Sheets. We live in the future. Truly, we live in the future.